How many want to have God come here today? You know how to do that? Because he inhabits the praises of his people. The more we praise him, the more he's going to get in here. So why don't we do that? Why don't we lift our hands and glorify him and praise him? Oh, hallelujah. Isn't it good to be together again? Praising the Lord. Amen. It's good to be together again. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. He is wonderful. He is wonderful. He is worthy. Praise the name of God. Hallelujah. Put everything aside. Everything aside. All the emotional traumas. All the physical traumas. All the emotional. All the mental. Relational. Anything that you're battling right now. Put it aside. It's time to worship the Lord. It's time to come together and get our minds and our hearts filled with the goodness of Jesus Christ. Praise God. Hear the wonderful word of God that'll change us. Give us to what we need. We want to be like Jesus, don't we? We want to be like him. And the only way to do that is to become a spiritual person. A person that walks as he walked here upon the face of the earth. Praise God. Go ahead, Sister Byrne, sing another song. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen.
Just praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen, 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 amen. Praise the Lord. That's what I like. You can bring God right into a place if you know the secret, right?
Yes.
You gotta know the secret. That's why we study the Bible. That's why we break open the Bible and we try to, we try to find out how to get to God. You know, it's one thing, you know, for a preacher to stand up and say, you should do this, you should do that, you should do that. I grew up with that kind of spirit. You know, you need to do this, you need to do that, need to do this. But you know what? It's a different ministry when they start telling you how to do this.
Yes.
How to do that.
Yes.
Now,
amen.
I want God in every aspect of my life. Right? Don't
yes.
you? Every aspect
yes.
of my life. Whether it's good or whether it's bad. You know, some people go to church and try to come to church. I don't want to call it serving God, but they come to church with the aspect of the Lord taking care of a problem in their situation.
Everything.
To try to fix everything in their lives. And you know, that's really not the right concept to come to church for. Because it's not going to work that way. You can't. God doesn't barter. God's not something you turn off and on. But building a relationship in Christ, you're going to find when you have that relationship, when the middle of a trouble, when the things get hard, instead of getting mad and cussing the God out or expressing yourself in an angry spirit, you know what to do?
Praise
Him.
Thank you, Jesus.
How do you know that, Brother Zonneveld? What does that do? Because when you start praising Him, you know what that Bible, the Bible gives that term, where is that? 108 Psalm or something like that. That when you do that, and when you start praising Him, the phrase that's used, He inhabits the praises of His people. Mom, you know where that's at?
Whenever I try to sing or try to do things, I give out.
Yes.
But I thank God that I'm here and can listen to it.
Yes,
amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
That,
yes.
Somebody find that. Come on, church. Get to work. Dig it out. He inhabits the praises. Just put inhabit. Come on, you guys get your phones and put inhabit in there. It'll come up. He inhabits the praises of His people. You know what that means? That simply means this. That's the King James Version, right? But what that simply means is that He dwells in the middle of those praises. Now that tells me something. Gives me a secret. It unlocks a very simple. It's a very simple secret. But it's still, a lot of people don't understand that. Because they come to church to get God to do something for them. But do you know what? I don't come to church to get God to do something for me. I come to church to build a relationship with the Lord. Because if He doesn't fix my problems, they're only temporary anyway. But Paul said that. Second chapter of 1 Corinthians, I might be off. I'm getting old, so I don't, but it's in the Bible. Just look for it. But Paul the Apostle said those things that are natural, he called them temporal in the King James. That, you know what that word means? Temporary.
Yeah.
They're only temporary. But what we do for God, it lasts.
Yes.
It's eternal. So that, am I going to make to serve God to make everything work out right? No, I don't need to.
No.
Because everything's going to work out the way God would want them to work
Amen.
Out.
That's
if
right.
I go ahead and serve the Lord, and when trouble hits me, praise God, I want Him in the middle of my troubles, don't you?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I want Him right there, inside those troubles. You know what I do? Praise God.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Lord, I praise you. Lord, I praise you. You know, some people say, that's nuts. You only say, oh, God, help me, deliver me, God, help me. No, I praise Him. Because you know what? When I praise him, his spirit, his presence is right there with me in the midst of that trial.
Yes.
And what, after all, every trial that if I use it in the right perspective and I use those trials, every trial can be what? A stepping stone.
Yes,
to come up closer to Jesus Christ. I'm so happy God has brought us here tonight.
Amen.
And the feeling that I have and the spirit that is in this place.
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Did you find it yet?
I didn't find the one you asked for.
We're 95, 1 and 2.
Pardon?
22 and 3. Psalms 90.
Oh,
that's it.
Psalms 91.
There
we go.
It says, "Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord.
Yes.
Let us make a joyful noise."
That's 91. Go ahead.
"To the rock of salvation."
Yes.
"Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving."
Amen.
"Make a joyful
bless
noise
Lord.
Unto him with psalms."
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Here he said, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabits the praises of his people." Of Israel. That is Israel, but that we're people. We're the people of God. Paul the Apostle, again, made a statement in the book of Galatians, I believe it is. He said, "We are a Jew, not outwardly, but inwardly." You know what he's trying to tell you right there? Because the Jewish, God's favorite, was God's favorite. He had favor with them, or they had favor with him, as they walked in the principles and the law. As long as they walked in the principles of the law, they had favor with God. That tells me something else, doesn't it, to you? Well, if I'm walking in the Spirit of God and I'm walking and conducting myself and trying to build my relationship with him, don't you think he can take every burden off of me? He can take every heartache off of me. He can give me the strength and the power to endure. Oh, God, don't take it away. Just give me the strength and the power to endure. Let me stand, because in this age we're living in, I'm telling you, it's getting harder. I've got a question. I've got several questions that have come in, and I'm not going to cover them tonight. I don't believe it will. But there was one question that come in that said, "Where in the Bible does it say there is no promise for tomorrow?" Well, that's a good question, isn't it?
Yes.
There is no promise for tomorrow.
No, there isn't.
No, you have to rely upon the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes. For tomorrow.
He doesn't make everything go away. He doesn't make everything better.
No,
the better that he makes it is, he's there with you.
Yes.
Does it really matter?
That's right.
Does it really matter?
No.
That those disciples that walked with Jesus, they went through turmoil, they went through, they went through all kinds of avenues. Even Peter was crucified upside down. That was his will. He didn't want to be crucified right side up, because he didn't want to be equal with the Savior. He wanted to be crucified upside down. Those men exercised, and can you imagine here, Paul the Apostle, God called him. Paul was structurally, he was a small fellow, very small fellow. He was a little bit overweight. He was a tent maker. That's what his profession was. And he was dwelling here in the earth, and they would put him in jail for what he believed. Every time, several times, he was in prison in Rome, especially. And he was held there for years, and all that time, all those letters that you read, the letter in book of Romans, he wrote that from jail. The book of Ephesians, he wrote that from the jail cell. And Paul never complained. He held on to what he believed in, and he stood for what he believed in. Now, we have not been put in jail yet for what we believe, but it's coming. It's coming. The direction of it is coming. Somebody said, not in America. That, listen, I never thought prayer would be taken out of the schools. I never thought the Bible was outlawed in a school system. I never thought that the relationship that is built in people's lives in the school system is that they are their own person, that they can make their own decisions. And you know, that's contrary to the Word of God. Because the Bible
that keeps a person in a good moral state. Even if they didn't believe in God, the structure that's in that Bible presented a moral standard that is now that's done away with. It's outlawed. And what has it produced? It's produced to where armed guards have to be in the elementary system of our school system. They have just recently made the statement there will be armed guards in those schools because children are being shot and children are being abused right there in the school system. Yeah. Now, I'm going to tell you something. That's a product of taking God out of the system. But here today, I'm telling you here today, here's a question that came in the prophecy of the Middle East, the turmoil that's going on right now in Israel. Where is that in the Bible? Where does that state in the Bible? Interesting question, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
We'll come back. Because I'll cover it.
Yes.
Because there is Bible for it.
Yes, there is.
Praise the name of the Lord. You know, we're living in Bible times right now.
Yes.
We're living in Bible times right now.
Yes, we are.
Israel, I'm going to say this. Israel is going to go through HELL. They're going to go through it. Because their attention is not focused on the Lord Jesus Christ. They reject Him. And they don't accept Him. Now, there are some, I know some, that have received Him, and they're filled with the Holy Ghost, and they accepted the Lord. But in general, the population, though, of Israel doesn't accept Christ. They look at Him as a prophet, or they might accept Him as a person of high moral standards. But let me tell you something. That Israel is going to be brought down to their knees.
Yes.
To where they have no absolute understanding but to turn to Jesus Christ. The Bible said, and they'll know Him by the nail prints in His hands. Blessed be the Lord. But let me tell you, before that event happens, God's going to have a church in the earth that's going to do it as God intended for the church to operate.
Amen.
And to be governed by and to have the Holy Spirit and the Word of God flowing to the depth and the understanding of the Word of God, because He is going to have an overcoming body of people on the face of the earth that are going to rule and reign with Christ.
Yes.
That is not completed yet, dear child of God. That has not been completed yet. But God is bringing a body of people together that are going to be led by the Holy Ghost. How many are going to be led by the Spirit of God?
Amen.
Hallelujah. We need the Holy Spirit to come in and lead us and guide us and instruct us. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord. We don't need another argument about some doctrinal issue. We need to feel the very expression of Christ in our hearts and in our lives. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Whether there is three in the Godhead, or whether there's one in the Godhead, or whether there's two in the Godhead, right now is immaterial. Right at this moment, we don't need that philosophy or rather that doctrine established. It's already established in the church. In the church I'm talking about. I'm not talking about religious playhouses. I'm talking about the church of Jesus Christ. Let me understand what I'm saying right now. Because there are theatrics that are used in the church. There's entertainment that's being used in churches. God's not in that. God doesn't want that. God wants the people of God to be developed into a Christ-like being, that where they can rule and reign with Christ Jesus. Can you lift your hands and praise Him with me? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. It's not in the entertainment. I feel good sometimes when a song is being sung. I feel good when somebody gets up and talks. I feel motivated by some motivational speakers at times. But let me tell you something. my interest in church is to develop a closer relationship with Jesus Christ. Blessed be the Lord. Hallelujah. You don't have to bring modern music into the church. I'm not opposed to that. Please don't take that wrong. But that doesn't bring the Lord into church. That brings people into church. But let me tell you something. You stop that and they'll stop coming. But when they come for the reason of hearing what God can do in their hearts and in their lives, and they grip the truth in their heart, and a closer relationship in Christ is built in their lives, you won't be able to pull them out of the church. They'll stay. Blessed be the name of the Lord. They'll hold on to the principles of the Word of God. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, help me preach. Praise the name of the Lord, because we're living in that kind of day.
Yes,
praise God. Hallelujah. That's what caused Brother Jerry to pack up and move over here in West Palm, from West Palm right here. Or was it Jupiter? Where were you from?
West Palm.
Jupiter?
Yeah.
Okay, he's from Jupiter. Who lives there? Who did live there? He got his house taken away from what's his name again?
Bert.
Old Bert Reynolds lives there. He's got a big old mansion, but they've foreclosed on him because he didn't make the payments on it. You know, that times are like that right now. Times are like that. People, you know, let me give you this thought right here. If the cost of living goes up 10%, say, per se, and it goes up 10% and they raise your salary, they say it's an updated salary, and it... what is it? It's a
cost
of living raise. They give you a cost of living raise, and it's only 5%. Well, what happens? It doesn't cover the additional cost or the additional expenses, and that is what's happening in the economy today. But oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, the things that I'm buying, they're temporary. That red truck out there, it is temporary. That motorhome out back, it is temporary.
Yes.
It is not going to go with me. It's not going to be there with me. It's going to be destroyed. The house I live in, it's temporary. Praise God. The car my wife drives, it is temporary.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. It's all temporary. And the expense is going up higher. I noticed I was doing my bills yesterday, and I noticed something. My income is not as great as it used to be because the expenses are much higher. But do you know what? It doesn't matter. I just lift my hands and praise the Lord because He's going to see me through it. Brother Jerry, He's going to see you through it. He's going to give you a job where you'll be making money. Blessed be the Lord. And Lauren be traveling over here more. The once she gets this in her heart and in her spirit, because God is working on a people. Blessed be the Lord. Amen. And you know what? Somebody said, I'm so excited I can't get the words out. How many are praying for me right now? Hallelujah! Blessed be the name of the Lord. God's people are a special people. Praise God. We're a special people. Hallelujah. You know, not everybody hears what we're hearing right now. You know, there could be people sitting in this building that are not hearing what the Lord is saying to this congregation at this very moment. Praise the Lord. But those of us who are hearing and we're deciphering that God is speaking to the church, praise the name of God. You know what? We're excited. Praise God. We get turned on by what God is doing in this age we're living in. So we're glad. We're glad, and we have the Middle East prophecy, that question came.
Mm-hmm.
And then another question came, and I believe this is the area that they're talking about. They asked the question about shaking. Have you ever heard the term shaking in the Bible?
Yes.
Have you ever heard the term that says God will shake everything that could be shaken?
Yes.
Is that the question? Whoever wrote this question in? Is that the question? I see a head going real vigorously. Yes. All right. We're going to talk on that.
Yeah.
We're not going to talk on it tonight, but we're going to talk on it. And I just want you to know I have these questions here.
Yes.
But do you know what? I can't cover these right now.
Yep.
You know why? Because the Holy Ghost is not telling me to cover these things right now.
That's right.
Blessed be the Lord. Now they're here.
Yeah.
They're here.
Yes, they are.
And God wants them answered. I feel that. I feel that God wants these questions answered. But there's a time and a season and a purpose for everything.
Hallelujah.
And you know who provides that time and that season and that purpose? Is when we are connected to the Holy Spirit, He'll bring that and He'll say, it's time. It's time. It's time to talk about the shaking. The shaking. Blessed be the Lord. Because right in the middle of that shaking, and there's going to be a shaking, all right. But right in the middle of that shaking, you can be right there. Because God's going to check you out. And He's going to shake you. He's going to see if you're going to stand. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So get prepared. Get prepared.
Yes.
He's going to shake you. Praise God. You might be on cloud nine right now. And you might feel like, oh God, I'll never turn. I'll never go back. But let me tell you something. God can bring a shaking. Praise God. He can shake you. He can shake you. And He can see where your faith is at. Praise the Lord. Because every person has to be proven. Every individual has to be proven in the sight of God.
Right.
You have nothing to prove to me. Nothing. You don't have nothing to prove. That doesn't mean you're proving something. That means that you are in a position that where you are an individual that is planted in the Word of God. Blessed be the Lord. And if there's a shaking of temptation come, praise God.
Amen.
All right. Praise the Lord. I feel like the Lord wants me to stop. We're glad to have, and I said, Jerry Lauren, we're glad to have them here. What did I say?
It's Laurel.
Okay, Laurel. Okay. Laurel.
He's bad.
I'm bad with names, Laurel. Don't take offense. I don't even know her name half the time. And then we're glad to have Sister Grace's granddaughter back there.
Amen.
And I forgot her name already. Jessica, that's right. I got a daughter named Jessica.
Yes.
So, but we're glad to have Jessica here. This is Sister Grace's granddaughter.
Praise
and I know that makes Sister Grace just feel like she's walking on cloud nine to have her granddaughter.
Praise the Lord.
With her in church. We're so happy. And there's quite a few of our folks that are missing, and we want to hold them up in prayer.
Yes.
But it's still a good crowd for Friday night, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Amen.
And so we're, we want to remember Sister Connie and Sister Dee Dee. Let's ask the Lord to help her.
Yes.
Help them through this. And then also, I noticed Sister Tammy's not here. Sister.
She's out there.
She's out there? Okay.
She's okay.
All right, Sister Tammy.
She's sitting in a soft seat.
All right, Sister Tammy, you belong in here with us.
She's sitting in a soft seat.
Well, she can sit in her soft seat.
There are soft seats in here. And there'll be more softer seats when we get our building done.
Yes.
But we're going to... I'm glad she's here, though. Okay,
amen.
Praise God.
Yes.
And then we want to remember Sister Alice.
Yes.
And the boys.
Yes.
That the Lord would help her. Sister Alice is in a tremendous amount of pain all the time.
Yes.
And she can't get around. She can't even, function in the home. And so we want to pray that Sister Alice, God can give a miracle in her heart, in her lives.
Yes.
And then who else is there? That's Josh.
Sister Marilyn.
Yes. Chris Kelly and several people. And I'm not...
Brother Rico,
there's Josh right there. Brother Rico, Sister Cindy.
Yes.
Wow, there's another congregation that's missing, isn't it?
There is.
Yes, but God knows.
Yes.
God does, you know what? I've come to the conclusion he has here who he wants here.
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
God has here whom he wants here.
Yes, amen.
See there, I just start mentioning names and they come in. Here's God.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. So we're glad. And then we want to keep this spirit and atmosphere in our church.
Yes.
And incidentally, before I go, there is a work day tomorrow, and please come if you can, and I assure you there'll be something for you to do.
Oh, yes.
And we're in a phase now that it's drywall finishing time, and if you have any kind of experience in finishing drywall, or even putting the mud on the wall to some degree,
yes.
And Sister Marcia would appreciate it. She's our drywall finisher.
Yay.
Amen.
Thank you.
Somebody said, well, we don't have a drywall finisher. You go in there and look. There's a professional job going on. I'm really trying to keep my house in order. No, seriously, she's doing a real good job. And I'm glad that she... But physically, it's very taxing on her. But there'll be people here tomorrow. Sister Stacy will be here and working with her in that area. But Brian's going to be painting the outside of the building. Oh, my goodness. Praise God. That'll put a nice feature. But God has helped us. And all that we've done in that building right now, I finally took a tally on it, and so far, what we have spent is $1,800.
Mm-hmm. Praise
and
the
look
Lord.
At what we have accomplished.
Yeah. Praise
Isn't that
the
wonderful?
Lord.
That's all we got invested. And then the owner of the building is supplying the paint.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that wonderful? They don't have to do that. You know, commercial rental is a lot different than, housing, house rentals. Because I've dealt with rentals for 20-some-odd years, and it's a different thing. When you rent commercial properties, guess who takes care of the inside? You do. And so you film it and shape it the way you want to. And she's given us permission to do whatever we want to do. And I spoke to her on the phone, and she for probably close to an hour yesterday. And she requested prayer. And I was talking to her after a while, and she didn't tell me her problem, but the Lord revealed it to me. Can you believe that?
Yes.
And I started counseling her, and she says, there you are, Pastor. You're counseling. She lives all the way down Cooper City, but God can bring her to come by. She never met us.
Amen.
Never met me, but she has a sweet spirit towards us. And she can't hardly wait to meet us, and she's trying to hold back until we get done with what we're doing to where she can see. But she's excited. But you pray for her. Her name is Beth. I don't even remember her last name. But Beth is a wonderful person, and she has really, she said, I proposed to her. I said, I didn't propose to her, but I said to her, I would be in trouble. You know? But I mentioned to her, I was saying something, and she said, wait a minute, John. I said, what, Beth? And she said, I am not
anticipating selling that building to nobody but you, if you ever, if it's ever sold. You're not moving out of there. I said, but Beth, this building could rent for a whole lot more than what you're renting it to us. She said, I know that, but I'm giving it to you at this price. Praise
Amen.
God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And she's just anticipating, and then she's going to send me, she's sending me a layout at the parking lot because she has pressured Pinch and Penny to fix these holes out here that they've caused in the driveway.
Yeah.
Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
I said, well, what's that got to do with God? What is that got? I can tell you what it's got to do with God. God wants to send more people to this church.
Yes, he does. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
And I said, well, I doubt it. You know, well, if God sends them, you know, that's how we've traveled all these years. You know, God has to send them. But you know what? God also helps us. Because you know what? When a person walks in this place that's not spiritual, doesn't have the Holy Ghost, you know what they look at? The appearance. They look at the surroundings. That's what catches their first eye. And you know what I want to do? I want to make it. I'm not making this thing into a glorious mansion, but I'm going to tell you, I want it nice and clean, neat. And when they walk in the door, there won't be a distraction.
Amen. That's right.
Because that's a distraction.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And when that distraction is gone, the Holy Spirit, they're going to focus on what we're saying, what we're doing. Oh, God, I'm excited, let me tell you.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, amen.
I'll coin the phrase that I've heard several years, and let me tell you, I saw it work. I hear the footsteps.
Yep. Amen.
And let me tell you, I heard a preacher do that one time, and his church filled up to the, they had to put chairs in the aisles. They had to put chairs all over the front of the house.
Yes.
Every service, people were packed in that building like sardines. 80 building, packed with people. And it started off with just a handful of us. Really, it was a handful. In fact, we had such a small group. And we had a huge platform. We took some seats off the platform, and put them on the, where the seating was. There's just a handful of us. That's how we started. Then a few came in, and Brother Paul and Sister June came in. They were in that assembly. They came in. Others came in. And they were established, Word of God was being preached, and just one instance, the Holy Ghost revealed there are people coming. Amen. You know what? I hear the sound of footsteps.
Yeah.
I want my heart to be right.
Yeah.
And you know the only way God can use us? Because we're going to have to become a body. We're going to have to function together. I can't have my own opinion. I've got to have the same opinion.
Yes, Lord.
We're not going to create clones.
No.
But we're going to feed. And we're going to be, there are two things. What were the two words? Can you all remember the two words?
Passion.
And focus. Everybody say it with me. Passion and focus. We're going to focus.
Yes.
And we're going to have passion.
Yes.
The only way for you to help a person reach God, you're going to have a passion for them.
Amen.
All right. So, sister, well, let's do that. Let's go to prayer and ask the Lord to cover us. And then Sister Brewer can head out with another chorus or so, if that's the Lord's will. But just incidentally, the services here are not conducted. We don't have anything planned.
Somebody said, oh, how can you do that? Well, I've done it all the time I've been in the ministry, and it works. There's no planned service. So, what does that do? If the Holy Ghost is talking to you, don't sit there like a bump on the log.
I gotta say something.
All right, get up and say it.
I've been wanting to see it.
All right, go on, come on. That's Brother Jerry. Praise God. Amen.
I couldn't wait to come here and tell y'all. I could talk for hours for you, what God's been moving and what God's been doing to me.
Amen.
But I want to let you know the power in this man through God. That he's influenced me so much.
God bless
you. My mom had surgery, mm-hmm. and she was down here, and she was in the room, and all I could do was call him, get a hold of him. I just wanted to talk. He said, do you think she wants some prayer? I said, well, she does, but she's really not in the right. She just got out of intensive care. I said, let me go see. And I went, and she was sleeping. And I said, I got a couple minutes. I'll meet you anywhere you want. So we shot down to the Village Inn, and I didn't know we were going to have a little mini Bible study, but that was fine by me. We're sitting there talking, and I'm saying my ideas, and he's telling him what. I said, I got to get out. I got to come down here. And we kind of laughed and chuckled about that. I think one time I said, you know what, it's really weird. As you said the first, second time I came in, you said, well, you know, maybe I got a feeling he's going to be down. He's going to be coming down. For a million years, I never could imagine I'd be here, moving here, or wanting to be an instrumental part of this church.
Praise the Lord. Here I am.
Praise the Lord.
And I didn't know that it was prophecy until this next thing came upon me that day. He says,
bless him, Lord.
You're busy, I'm busy, you got everything going on. And he said, well, let me, we started talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And he starts talking about everything. And I'm like, yeah. He's like, you know what you really got to pray for? Tongues. I said, no, that's the most misused thing that someone can grab hold of. I said, I run from that.
Yes.
I said, I respect you because I've heard you say a couple of words, and I know it's there, and I know it, but I said, I'm not ready for that. I'm not. I don't know what. I said, I pray for things like I need, like money. Money! Whoa! I said, well, you asked me. I said, that's my way I pray for what I need. You know, and I guess that's not bad. You know, he says, well, it's just the money word, you know. And I said, well, you know, I in my need, God hears my call. And he said, well, you know, I'm feeling that you need to pray for tongues because tongues is getting ready to hit you. I'm like, yeah. All right. Okay, well. All right, if you say so. I don't know if I'm prayed for it, by the way. So I said, I gotta go. I'm worried about mom. So we hugged each other, and I left. And I said, but you will be the first phone call I make when it happens, or when it happens, or if it happens. But I told him, I said, I know God's gonna give it to me on my own terms when I'm ready.
Right.
So I picked. I was working, trying to get things going, and trying to make the move. And all my friends are my friends. You got no friends when you're moving. Everybody knows.
Yeah.
So this goofball that I hired before, he has a bad appearance. He acts goofy. He has spurt, but his spirit was something else, you know. And along they were saying, and I was going to church and other. They were saying, don't look at the person in the flesh.
Right.
Look at him in the spirit.
Amen.
So I was just like, okay, I'm going to try it. Because, sorry, I'm not going to look at him. I'm just going to love on him and try to teach him and guide him. And if he acts crazy and goofy, I'm just going to be embarrassed. But I'm not going to ridicule him like I did. I'm not going to try to fix him. I'm just going to go with it. And he worked all day and night for minimum pay and was there for me. Like, It was like God sent him to me.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, there's something to this. And then right at a pivotal moment, we're talking about God and we're praying a lot, and I, my phone broke and I need to get another phone. And I said, you know what? What you're doing for me, driving me to go get this phone, is so much. We've been driving for hours and nothing was going right. He was about ready to give up. And I said, listen, we have to push. We only had like 10 minutes to do this major thing. And then we had to drive all over. And he was getting irritated. But he did it. And I was like, oh, man. I mean, that's awesome. I said, you're down for me. I go, you know what? You've been doing things for me. Like, let's just pray. So I want to pray for you. Amen. That God help me to help you with your quirks. You're helping me with what I said God puts together. Amen. So we're holding the cross and we're praying. And he said, come on, Spirit. Come on. Come with it, Spirit. And we're praying. And I'm just like, God, we don't know why. We don't know what. But we just ask you, please come in. Mm-hmm. We're begging you. Help me and help him. And all of a sudden, like waves of I mean, I felt it like I was only felt it two times before that hard, and I just began weeping and crying and screeching, praising him, thanking him for him to come in. And he let off into some tongues, like I went, whoa! I'm not expecting this from you. Not goofy goofball. No, not tongues.
Yeah.
Tongues? He's like, yeah, I do it all the time. It's like nothing, you know. Yeah, I mean, God, we talk all the time. And
yeah.
We're just, yeah, you know. And I'm like, right at that moment when I stopped looking at his flesh.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I said, you know what?
Amen.
I want to be your Christian brother. And let's just praise God together for help. I'm helping you in your way. You're helping me in your way.
Mm-hmm.
There I got the tongues. No heat from him. So open my mind. So I'm like, surely he would not misuse it or make it up at the time like this right here.
Right.
So that was the most genuine. So a couple days went by. Went to, was Pentecostal Sunday, the next Sunday coming up. And I really, really felt the Spirit going on there too. And another miraculous thing happened, but that's too much another story. But they laid hands on me. I wanted to get healed. And I was like, God, I know it's good. I know I'm going to get healed now, God. I'm with you. You're showing me things. Yeah. So a couple days went by. I'm scratching my foot more than ever. God, I'm a little disappointed in you, God. Why didn't you heal me then? If you're not going to heal me now for my scratchy foot, when am I going to get healed? You know? So I got all depressed all day. I was just not myself. And I'm curled up in the office, like sleeping, when I should be moving and doing these other things. And just my heart was hurt. And I was like, all of a sudden, Wayne came in, that's his name. He came in and he says, that's it. God just told me I need to pray. Just, I need to say something. And he grabbed the Bible and he shook it, said, God, give me the scripture. I mean, he opened the Bible and it said something like this. Don't let your heart be hurt right now because I didn't answer your prayers when you wanted them answered right then, my son, or something like that. He says, I'm with you.
Mm-hmm.
Be glad that you're not, that you're getting to know me now rather than on your deathbed with gray hair.